And joining me now, Bob Cusack is editor-in-chief of The Hill, joins us now. So, Bob, looking at these results last night, what can Democrats take away as you look towards 2018 midterms?
Well, it just shows you that politics can change very quickly. I mean, Democrats are now running on Obamacare, and they basically lost the House in 2010 and the Senate in 2014 because of the Affordable Care Act. And now it is a political asset, as Republicans have tried, and at least so far, failed to repeal it. So it was a big night for Democrats, especially 1 year. This is the anniversary of Trump's win a year ago. They badly needed it. They had lost some close special elections for House seats that they could have won, and this was big. This was a big win. Now, also, though, Hillary Clinton won Virginia by more than 5 points, but Northam outperformed her. So this is a big deal.
So on top of these two governorships that the Dems won, they also made big gains in down-ballot candidates like state lawmakers. How significant is that, and what can Dems do with those seats?
It's significant because Republicans have dominated at the state legislatures, in Congress, and winning back these seats shows you that. I mean, they won coast to coast. This was a big wave election. Now, there weren't that many seats when you compare it to next year, the midterm elections. But this gives them hope, and I think this will help donations. I think the Democratic donors are going to be opening up their pocketbook because they may say, hey, maybe we can win the House back in 2018.
And President Trump, when you look at his record low approval ratings, 37%, this is according to the latest Gallup poll. Is it fair to say this was a referendum on him?
I think so. I think a lot of people, I live in Northern Virginia, and Democrats were fired up. They were very organized, and arguably more organized for this governor's race than they were in 2016. They were hungry, and it's because of Trump. Now, not everyone was voting anti-Trump, but clearly he was a factor in this race. And honestly, in governor's races, you know, you can see a lot of Democrats winning in red states in governor's races. In federal elections for Congress, usually it's more along party lines. So this is a bad sign for Republicans. I talked to a Republican a little while back, and this was before the election, and he said 50-50 that we lose the House. I think those chances are definitely on the increase now.
You mentioned the Virginia race there. The Republican gubernatorial candidate Ed Gillespie ran on some of President Trump's issues, but he also distanced himself from the president. Steve Bannon, he actually told the New York Times that over the weekend, before the election, in Gillespie's case, Trumpism without Trump can show the way forward. We now know Gillespie didn't win. So what do you think Republicans would likely take away from this?
I think Republicans have several takeaways, and one of them is that Trump is not on the ballot in 2018. Now, you can look at it different ways. Well, Republicans haven't got health care done, they haven't gotten taxes done, they haven't gotten much done legislatively. So what was the reason for the base to show up? And as you mentioned, Gillespie kind of embraced Trump, never appeared with him on the stump. So the Bannons of the world can say, listen, he didn't embrace him enough. I think that clearly the atmosphere and the politics around it, no matter what, Northam was going to win this race because he won so convincingly. But that's going to be the rub. How much do Republicans embrace Trump or not? I think it depends on their district and their state.
You mentioned also, you know, these Republican lawmakers' retirements. When you talk about that, to more people announcing their retirements, Congressman Frank Lobiondo of New Jersey, mm-hmm. and also Ted Poe of Texas. Do you think this sort of wave of exits have anything to do with the climate that you're mentioning in Washington when you're concerned about reelections?
Yes, and it's hard to say with certainty which one is because of Trump and which one is because Lobiondo is 71 years old, but he is in a swing district. It's a district that Trump won by a handful of points, so Democrats are now going to be definitely going after that seat. Now it's going to be in an open race, and you're going to see more retirements in the House. There's no doubt about it. This is kind of the retirement season. I think it was wise for those two members to announce their retirement before the race last night, but there's going to be more, and every Republican retirement in a swing district or pseudo swing district increases the chance that the Democrats can win back the House. But it's still, they've got to win 24 seats. That's a lot of seats.
Yeah, it certainly is a lot of seats. The exit polling, Bob, was also so fascinating last night, showing health care a top issue among those in Virginia, especially followed by gun policy, tax cuts, immigration also listed. When you look at those, do you think lawmakers and state party officials, what do they take away from that moving forward? And is there going to be traction on health care?
I think there is some traction on health care. I think the dilemma for Democrats is how much they're going to run on guns. Remember in 2009 and 2010 with Obama in the White House and they had Democratic majorities, they didn't go near gun control. Now, that was a different time before many mass shootings. So will Democrats run on gun control, something they've avoided for so long? It does poll well now in the wake of these tragic shootings, but I think that's going to be a tough one. Democrats have to come up with a clear message, and they don't have that yet, but they've got a lot of time. They've got a year to develop one.
Yeah. At the same time, you also look last night at Maine. It was also fascinating to see that race and how they became the first state to expand Medicaid by ballot initiative. So the GOP governor there, Paula Page, vetoed this deal five times under Obamacare. How significant is that? And is this sort of a model for other states to follow? Do you see that happening?
Yeah, I think so. It could. Now, this was, as you mentioned, this is the first state to have voters vote and actually get it cleared, expand Medicaid. And it looks like the legislature could block that, but it doesn't look like that's going to be the case. There are 32 states now that have expanded Medicaid. And in those other 18, a lot of them which are red, they may not pass. But certainly this is another sign that Democrats are playing offense instead of defense on health care.
Fascinating to look at these numbers and the polling and the statistics afterwards. Bob Cusack, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Rena.